Batteries are important for us. They may be small or large. Hope you will wonder, when the power cuts in our house, the inverter automatically supplies the power. We'll explain that process in detail later, but the heart of that system is a battery. Typically, the tubular type of battery is preferred for inverters due to its reliable power delivery, longer backup time, and relatively low maintenance requirements. You might notice that batteries have different sizes, and this is frequently related to their intended backup duration. Larger batteries usually hold more energy-storing materials. This capacity is commonly measured in units like ampere hours, AH, or watt hours, WH. As a result, you'll often find labels on batteries showing MAH, milliampere hours, and voltage, V. So when you see MAH on a battery, it's telling you about its capacity to hold and deliver electrical charge over time, which is a key factor in determining how long your device will run on a single charge. First, if you look at the top of most lead-acid batteries, you'll typically see two prominent terminals, a positive one and a negative one. Also on top, you'll usually find ventilation in some form, often small caps or a channel. This allows for the safe release of gases that can be produced during the charging process. Now, if we open the battery, you will find battery blocks or compartments. Each of these blocks houses individual cells. Inside a 12-volt battery casing, you would generally find six distinct cell blocks. Each of these blocks contains the positive and negative plates and the electrolyte for that individual cell. Each of these blocks inside the battery is like a small individual battery. When you put them together in a specific way inside the battery case, their small amounts of electricity add up to give you the total voltage of the whole battery, like 12 volts. Just think, if we arrange two individual 1.5 volt batteries in the same way as the cells inside our battery, then the output voltage would be 3 volts. Let's see the cell arrangement. This is the positive plate, cathode. It is typically a grid made of a lead alloy and coated with a paste of lead dioxide, PbO2, which is the active material. This is negative plate, anode. This also consists of a lead alloy grid, and the grid is coated with spongy, porous lead Pb, the other active material. This is separators. The thin, non-conductive, and porous sheets are placed between each positive and negative plate. Their job is to prevent the plates from touching and causing a short circuit while allowing the sulfuric acid electrolyte to flow freely between them. The fundamental components are the same between the tubular and standard lead-acid battery, but the positive plate has a unique structure. Instead of a flat grid coated with lead dioxide paste, the active material, lead dioxide, is contained within porous tubes or gauntlets made of a fabric-like material. These tubes encase a lead spine, the conductive part of the grid, and are filled with lead dioxide paste. To understand its working function, let's focus on a single cell within this battery. So, we have taken a positive plate and a negative plate along with the electrolyte, which is sulfuric acid, H2SO4, mixed with water. Here, the positive plate is coated with lead dioxide, PbO2, and the negative plate is coated with spongy lead, Pb, when the battery is providing power. The positive plate, the lead dioxide, PbO2, reacts with the sulfate ions and hydrogen ions from the sulfuric acid. In this reaction results in the formation of lead sulfate, PbSO4, and water, H2O. Simultaneously, at the negative plate, the spongy lead, Pb, reacts with the sulfate ions and the sulfuric acid, form lead sulfate, PbSO4, and releases electrons, E. In this process, the lead loses two electrons. These released electrons then flow through the external circuit from the negative terminal towards the positive terminal. This flow of electrons is what we utilize as electricity. When power is supplied to the battery, the process reverses. At the negative plate, which now acts as the cathode during charging, the incoming electrical energy forces electrons into this electrode. The lead sulfate, PbSO4, that form during discharge reacts with these incoming electrons. This reaction converts the lead sulfate back into spongy lead Pb, and sulfate ions, SO4, are released back into the electrolyte, increasing the sulfuric acid concentration. Meanwhile, at the positive plate, the lead sulfate, PbSO4, reacts with water, H2O, and the removal of electrons. This process converts the lead sulfate back into lead dioxide, PbO2, and also releases sulfate ions, SO4, and hydrogen ions, H, back into the electrolyte, further increasing the sulfuric acid concentration. Hope you understood how it works. If you found this video helpful, please give it a big thumbs up and share it with others. Thank you for watching.